How does that fit with the architect?
How does that fit with the architect?
I'm thrilled. This will get me back in the Harvard Design School. Because
we'll be very happy.
All right.
Seemed like a simple question. Where do you want to go on vacation?
I said Paris.
The kids said Hawaii. Should have known. But Charter Pipeline had me online like that, so I didn't have to spend half my time waiting like with our old phone connection. Planned the whole trip myself.
Charter Pipeline, are you on?
We're not lost.
Aw, what just happened? Now what am I going to watch, Don? It's not like I'm surrounded by TVs.
Hi, I'm Iain. And as you just saw, I was just minding my own business, watching this old house on TV, and out of nowhere, done. Stopped. Why? Because the tube died. What? Your TV doesn't have tubes? That's just weird. Well, for those of you that do like to work on old TVs or old radios, you've all been there, where you're watching TV or you're trying out an old radio and it either won't turn on or it just dies out of the blue. Your immediate reaction is to turn the thing around and look through the vents to see if the tubes are glowing or not. Well, 9 times out of 10, if it's just died, they aren't glowing. Well, shouldn't it just be the tube that died not glowing? Why are they all not glowing? Well, the tricky thing is that you have a lot of these tubes, the heaters are wired in series, like the little Christmas lights where when one goes out, they all go out. So when one filament burns out, and they're called heaters, filaments, depending on what book you see them in, they're called different things. But really, if you hear somebody talking about a tube filament and a tube heater, they're the same thing. A little bit of variation whether they're directly heated cathodes or indirectly heated cathodes. Not making the distinction here, it's whatever pops into my head first is what I call them. And so, those little heater slash filament thingies are all wired in series, 9 times out of 10. And when one goes out, they all go out. And most tube failures are a result of the filament opening up. They just burnout. That's why you hear of tubes burning out, because most of the time that's what happens. And maybe they got dropped. Maybe it's just the thermal shock of the on-off, on-off, on-off over time. Maybe it's the high currents that they have when they start. Whatever it is, usually if a tube goes bad, that's what's caused it. And the easiest thing to do is to use a simple tester like this one that all it does is test to see if this filament is still connected or not. Now, I'm sure you're wondering, why would you use a tester like this, go through all the time and effort to make a tester like this, when you could just use a multimeter or, better yet, a vacuum tube voltmeter, and just check for continuity between the two filament pins. Well, the problem with just using a multimeter or a vacuum tube voltmeter to check for continuity is you have to remember where the pins for the heaters are. And if you don't know where the pins for the heaters are on a particular tube, you got to look it up. Then you're trying to hold the probes onto the pins. It's trying to roll across the workbench. And it gets frustrating if you're having to do an entire TV set of tubes. You want to just be able to plug it in, push a button, unplug it. Plug it in, push a button, unplug it. And that's what this does. You just plug it in, like so, push the button, and you know whether or not the tube is good. So, any second now, you should see the schematic for this thing appear on your computer screen. Now, before it does, I'm holding it back just a little bit, bear with me. The one real danger of this thing is that it uses line voltage. There is, when this thing is plugged in, 120 volts sitting inside these tube sockets waiting to get you. Now, it's not that big a deal as long as you aren't stabbing, like, paper clips and stuff into it, but if you don't feel comfortable working around 120 volts, or you don't feel comfortable having something where 120 volts is readily available, and by readily available I mean no more so than an outlet sitting in a wall where people could stab paper clips into, I don't recommend you make this. If you have doubts about your ability to work safely with 120 volts, but you want one of these things, you can always get somebody else that you know that is comfortable with 120 volts to just make it for you, and then you get it prepackaged. But just use some common sense when you're working around high voltages. And really, if you're working on pieces of equipment that use tubes, they use high voltages in them anyways, so my guess is you've gotten pretty comfortable around 120 volts and up. But just use some common sense, and here's the schematic for this better-than-nothing tube tester. Here's a better view of the top of the tester, and you can see that it has a 12-pin socket for the compactron tubes. It has an 8-pin socket. It has a 7-pin socket for the All-American 5 radios. The ones from the 50s usually had the 7-pin tubes, and the ones from the 40s and 30s usually had the 8-pin tubes, and then a 9-pin tube socket. So this does most of the tubes that you will run into for TVs and radios. Some of the later color TVs had the 12-pin ones, but those are kind of rare, so if you can't find a 12-pin compactron socket, don't worry. These three will cover quite a few tubes. And these are what two of the sockets look like on the bottom. And you can see there's a notch in the hole. That notch fits the notch on the center part right there. And when you're connecting things to this, you can see, well, I don't know if you can see, but I'll tell you, that with that notch right there, this pin is pin 1, and it goes around the circle, and pin 8 ends up being right here. So on the diagram, when you see the pins numbered, it's starting right here on the bottom with the notch. So that's the 8-pin version. The 9-pin, you have that
gap right there. So you have a whole bunch of holes and then a space. And again, it starts on the left of the space at 1, and it goes around until it reaches 9 right there. So that's how the pin numbers go on the sockets. And now, let's see this thing actually work. Now, this one is an 8-pin tube, so really easy. You just set it on top of the socket and then just spin it until the notch lines up. Once the notch lines up, push it in. Okay, the light is off. That's good. Now I'm going to press the test button, and if the filament is good in this thing, it will light up. Yay. It's a good tube, as far as the filament's concerned. Now, I could, in theory, just put another tube in here, push the button, and it would light up again. But because these sockets are wired in parallel, this one might have a blown filament, but because this one has a connection, it would still light up. So you only want to test one tube at a time. And now we can test a 9-pin tube. Yep, that one's good. 2 for 2. And a 7-pin tube. Okay, that one's good. Now, for the honesty test for this thing, we will try pushing the button without any tubes in. So, now that there are no tubes in it, when we push the button, this thing better not light up. Nope. Not lighting up. Good. So, that is a very basic tube tester. It doesn't take very long to make it. Doesn't cost very much. You can get tube sockets on the internet. You can get little neon bulbs on the internet with little neon bulb holders. The push button came from Radio Shack. This aluminum case came from Radio Shack. The rubber grommet came from a hardware store. The cord came from something. I don't know what the cord was off of. So there you go. If you deal with old TVs or old radios and you've been fighting with a multimeter trying to test the continuity between the filament pins for years and they've been rolling around, I highly recommend that you make one of these simple little testers so you have your first defense against bad tubes.